So before we open the Word of God and we open our sermon together, let's bow our heads and ask for the presence of the Holy Spirit. So shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you that the Sabbath hours are now upon us. Lord, as Dr. Sidney welcomed us in with those words of welcome and talking about the lighting of the candle, I pray, Lord, that as the darkness of our world gathers around us, so the light of our witness will shine brighter and brighter for you. Lord, I pray that during these Sabbath hours, each one of us will come to a deeper faith in Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that as a result of being at this camp meeting, through the singing, the preaching, the practical seminars, the classes, I pray, Lord, that our witness for Jesus will burn ever brighter from this day forward. Now, Lord, as I preach this sermon, Lord, I thank you for giving it to me. And Lord, I pray that I'll be a faithful servant in discharging this responsibility. Lord, I thank you for hearing this prayer. In Jesus' name I ask. Amen. So last night, we looked at the question of what are the administrative boundaries within the SDA church? And when somebody says that something is an administrative item that has been dealt with, what are the boundaries within our structure? And I came to the conclusion in my study on that, and I hope we all came to the conclusion ourselves, that while we are delighted and grateful that our church leaders at the conference, the union, the division, the GC level, while we are thankful that they do what they do, and many of them have very thankless tasks, there is a boundary of which they cannot cross. And actually, our conference leaders, our union, division, GC leaders, have precisely zero authority over any aspect of our lives. Zero. They cannot vote for anything in my life or your life. It's just a matter of fact. They cannot determine where you live, who you marry, what you wear, what you eat, what you spend your money on. They cannot determine what job you have, what part of the country you live in. If you move from Maine to Minnesota, then down to Florida, you don't have to ask anybody's permission about that. You are a free moral agent, and each one of us is accountable before God for the decisions that we make on a daily basis. It is not that we are amoral beings. It is not that we are unaccountable beings. We are morally accountable before our Heavenly Father for how we live our lives. And so while we affirm the fact that church leaders have no authority over the members, they cannot make any decisions for our lives, that does not mean that we are free of moral accountability. As Dr. Steve said earlier, or Sidney said earlier, there are angels in this house. There are the heavenly watchers we read about in the book of Daniel. And the heavenly watchers saw what Belshazzar was doing in his mocking of God in his feast. And because they noted what he was doing, he brought judgment upon himself. So we are moral beings. Every word, every deed, every action is transcribed in the records of heaven. The watchers are around us. And we will one day have to give account for every word and every deed in that final judgment. But tonight, I want to look at the question of whether we are a remnant church, a respectable church, or a regime church. And that's the journey we're going to go on today. So I'll try and make sure this thing works here. As I said last night, there's deep fake videos appearing all over the world these days. So I set up a YouTube channel. It's at conradvine@youtube.com. I'd encourage you to subscribe to it just because I try and post my sermons there when I find them on the internet. I don't post my own videos, but if other people do and it's genuine, I'll post it there. So I'd invite you to subscribe there, and then you'll see, at least I think, are genuine videos of myself. There may be fake videos out there, but that'll be a genuine website there. So this is our journey tonight. We're going to look at some previous GC and IRLA statements on religious liberty. I'll come to IRLA in a minute. I'm going to talk about the fact that the truth matters. I'm going to look at the impact of the reaffirmation statement on Adventists and what are the implications for us in the final crisis. Like, how do we respond? I'm sure these events come our way in the future. So we're going to start out by looking at GC and IRLA statements on religious liberty. Now, we're familiar what the word GC stands for. That's a general conference. That's like the highest conference in our church that organizes the world missionary work. But the IRLA was established over 130 years ago. It is the International Religious Liberty Association. It was established by our world church over 130 years ago because back in the day, in the 1870s and 1880s, we were convicted and convinced that liberty of conscience is going to be the battleground in the final crisis between good and evil. And I'm convinced of that today. And you can look up the IRLA, the International Religious Liberty Association today. It's run by the General Conference. It has delegates from all around the world church in it. And they produce some powerful statements. And every few years, they have a congress. So we're going to look at some of the statements that have come out of this organization. There's their website there, the International Religious Liberty Association. It's irla.org. I'd encourage you to check it out. There are some fascinating resources there. If you're a religious liberty leader in your local congregation, you want to take note of these things. And I encourage you just to take advantage of this. Actually, the church has an incredible wealth of information and resources out there that the average member has no idea exist. And I would encourage you to start looking at, say, the North American Division website or the Union websites, because they often have a plethora of resources out there that are very helpful for local churches and for you and your family and in your marriage. And we as regular members, we often have no idea it exists. Many of these things have got different brands on them. They're not all linked to one website. You have to go hunting for them. But this is a very, very helpful website here, the IRLA. And the IRLA voted some statements over the years. In fact, back in 1897, I think it was, the IRLA, the Adventist Church had a set of, like, they didn't call it fundamental beliefs, but they published a list of principles that we stand for. And I think it was number 17 stated that one of the core principles we stand for was liberty of conscience. It was actually, an original version of our fundamental beliefs. And we actually listed liberty of conscience as one of our core beliefs back in the 1890s. So from 1893, I've learned over the years that it's worth going to, when somebody dies, this is a hint for everybody here, when somebody dies, go to their house and ask the grieving children if you could take a look at the library. Because these days, people don't want the old books on the shelves. But you find real jewels on those shelves, real treasures. And a good library is a labor of love. I'll tell you why. Because for every 10 books that I read, I give away 8. It's not worth having. So if I give you a present, you need to think very carefully. I give away 8 because they're not worth having. But I keep 2 because they're really good. They're seminal books in their area of study. And so over the course of 10, 20, 30, 40 years of reading, you eventually end up with a library. All the books have been read multiple times, and those are like the core books in each of those areas. And I have other books. My bed collapsed a number of years ago. There's the mattress, there's the box thing underneath it. Then I've got these steel struts across, and they collapsed. So my wife said, what are we going to do about it? I said, well, people keep giving me books. Nobody from Maine, let me emphasize this, no books from Maine are under my book. Under my bed. And so I stack the books under my bed. And so when somebody says, did you like the book? I said, I keep it close to my head when I sleep, which is very true. But I've discovered that when you go to, when somebody dies, tragically, you go and visit the family, take a look at the books on the shelves. Because more and more people these days, they don't want to be troubled by those old dusty library volumes. But you find real treasures on those shelves. And I'd encourage you to do that. And I went to somebody's house recently who passed away, and I picked up a little red book. I thought it was one of Sister White's books. And then when I got it home, I inspected it a bit more closely, and it was some publications from 1893 from the International Religious Liberty Association. I was stunned. I did not know this resource existed. It was published by what then was our general conference back in the day. And I was reading through it, and there are all kinds of sermons from A.T. Jones in it, and all kinds of other things, fascinating stuff. And I came across some of these statements. So listen to these statements. This is what we stood for back in 1893. It says this: man's first and highest allegiance in all things is due to his creator. Therefore, the domain of conscience is one which human government, whether of one or of many, has no right to invade. No man can surrender his conscience to the keeping of another and maintain his loyalty to God. But as a responsible moral being, he must remain loyal to his creator at whatever cost, even at the sacrifice of life itself. And so just as the First Amendment with freedom of religion is the foundational right in our Bill of Rights, so liberty of conscience is the foundational religious freedom in the government of heaven. And when God created Adam in chapter 2 of the book of Genesis, the very first thing he said to him, before he said anything else, was, you may eat of every tree in this garden, but of that one tree, the knowledge of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat of it. And so the very first thing that God affirmed to Adam was that we are moral beings accountable to our heavenly creator, and our conscience is accountable to our heavenly creator and not to anybody else. 1893, W.W. Prescott wrote this in a sermon called Christ and the Sabbath. He says, it is a characteristic of Satan to compel, and every effort to compel in any of the consciences of men is what? Satanic. Every effort to compel the consciences of men in any way, whether it be the Sabbath or any other matter at issue, is satanic. God wins by the power of love. Amen. God leaves everyone to choose. Satan tries to compel. Every effort to compel the conscience is satanic, and the results will be satanic. So there we are, a sermon by W.W. Prescott, one of our early church leaders, in that Religious Liberty Library from 1893. We then had a declaration of principles that were voted by our church leaders back in 1893. And on the left-hand side, you have the declaration, one of those principles. It says there, we believe it is the right and should be the privilege of every man to worship according to the dictates of his conscience. Now you have a scripture reference on the right from Romans 12 and verse 1. And then skip forward 140 years and come to the 21st or 23rd of August, 2023. And every year, the General Conference has two meetings. There's the spring meetings and there's the annual council, which is normally in October. And that those two meetings are where the major decisions get taken between General Conference sessions. And then the ADCOM of the General Conference meets every month to deal with the issues as they come up. But every year, or every couple of years, the IRLA has a congress. And the last World Congress of the IRLA was in August 2023. And the General Conference, the Department Leader for Public Affairs and Religious Liberty, is a man called Dr. Ganon Diop. Some of you are familiar with him. And he was the instrument or the architect of the Church's statement in 21, denying religious liberty objections on the part of Adventists to mandates. But despite that, in 2023, this is what he was preaching in the IRLA Congress in the General Conference building in August 23. He said, religious liberty is, quote, the right to profess, practice, and propagate one's beliefs without coercion, intimidation, or manipulation. He went on to define religious liberty as, quote, freedom from being forced to do something that is against one's deeply held convictions or against one's conscience, end of quote. And so he explicitly recognized that religious liberty involves upholding your liberty of conscience, and your liberty of conscience, it doesn't give you the freedom to do as you wish. It means that you are no longer a slave to sin. You are now a slave to righteousness. It's not that we have become amoral beings. The liberty of conscience means that we are slaves to righteousness. We are servants of our loving Heavenly Father. And with the freedom that God gives us, we are to serve one another in love, as per the Apostle Paul. So Dr. Ganon Diop went on to say at annual council in October last year, he said, human conscience is sacred. It must not be violated by anyone. It is sacrilegious to constrain or pressure people to do something against the dictates of their conscience. Now, this was the man who put together the statement denying liberty of conscience in the pandemic. But this is what he says when the pandemic is over. Human conscience is sacred. It must not be violated by anyone. It is sacrilegious to constrain or pressure people to do something against the dictates of their conscience. He goes on to say this, no man is to think that he is the owner of the minds and capabilities of his brethren. He is not to think the others must submit to his dictation. He is liable to err, liable to make mistakes, as every man is. He is not to try to control matters in accordance with his ideas. And this particular quote here, is taken from the book This Day with God by Sister White, page 192. He then had another quote from the Spirit of Prophecy, and this particular one here from Councils on Health, page 345. This is what he quoted in the annual council last year of the General Conference. He said, it is not God's purpose that any human being should yield his mind and will to the control of another, becoming a passive instrument in his hands. No one is to merge his individuality in that of another. He is not to look to any other human being as the source of healing. His dependence must be in who? In God. It is in the dignity of his God-given manhood, he is to be controlled by God himself, not by any human intelligence. This is a quote there from Councils on Health, page 345. And Dr. Ganon Diop was correctly and rightly reflecting these very powerful statements from the writings of Sister White that uphold the basic truth that we are created in the image of God as moral beings, as morally accountable beings, and we are accountable to our Heavenly Father for every word and every deed in our lives. And there is no question about this. I once quoted this to my wife about my mother-in-law not being controlled by her, and she didn't see the humor in that particular comment. Some of you will. So the but then just to remind ourselves, as we discussed last night, this is the key paragraph in the October 21 reaffirmation statement where Dr. Ganun Diop, because it says there, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, in consultation with the health ministries, that was Dr. Peter Landless, and the public affairs and religious liberty departments, that's Dr. Ganun Diop, who in 2023 is such a champion of individual liberty of conscience. They are convinced, that's good news, that the vaccination programs that are generally being carried out are important for the safety and health of our members and the larger community. Therefore, and this is the key sentence, claims of religious liberty are not used appropriately in objecting to government mandates or employer programs designed to protect the health and safety of their communities. Now, what is a religious liberty objection? A religious liberty objection, by definition, is where the Holy Spirit convicts you not to do something. When the church says that the Holy Spirit, that you cannot say that the Holy Spirit is convicting you not to do something, this small group of men here are assuming the right to override the Holy Spirit. This is wrong. Doesn't matter what the issue is. Doesn't matter whether it's vaccinations or pork or beer or anything else. In this passage here, our church leaders assume the right to override the convictions of the Holy Spirit upon each of your consciences. And if they assume the right yesterday, they've established a precedent that can be used tomorrow, once again, to hurt the members. That is why we're talking about this today, because more mandates are coming. In 1923, the General Conference voted in full session this vote. It's an interesting vote, and you've got to go digging through the dusty books to find things like this. But this is what we voted in 1923. It says there, as American citizens, and this was actually an appeal to the U.S. federal government. So this vote was an appeal to the federal government in Washington, D.C., and this is what we voted. We said, as American citizens, we appeal on the ground of specifically declared constitutional rights to the free exercise of religion according to the dictates of the individual conscience, totally free and exempt from all government connection, interference, or control. But religion, or the duty which we owe to our Creator and the manner of discharging it, can be directed only by reason and conviction, and is nowhere cognizable but at the tribunal of the universal judge. We maintain, therefore, that in matters of religion, no man's right is abridged by the institution of civil society, and that religion is wholly exempt from its cognizance. We therefore, as Christians, as Protestants, as American citizens, and as men, appealing to the supreme judge of the world, that is God himself, for the rectitude of our intentions, solemnly publish and declare that we are, and of right, ought to be free and independent of all connection, direction, dictation, interference or control of the government of the United States in matters of religion or religious observances or religious institutions of any kind or degree. That's a powerful statement. We voted that in 1923 and we sent it to the federal government, affirming that we are morally accountable to God and we do not accept any government actions that would interfere with the free exercise of religion. Now, as it happens, you may ask this question, in America, we don't have the absolute right to the free exercise of religion because the Supreme Court has held that in things, let's say, as child sacrifice, you cannot sacrifice a living child in the pursuit of your religious observances, okay? So we don't have an absolutely untrammeled, absolutely unrestricted right to religious freedom. And so there is the right to practice in the First Amendment, and there is also the right to be free of a state church in the First Amendment as well. But our religious observance is not an absolute right in the Bill of Rights because some things have been restricted by the Supreme Court, such as child sacrifice. So this particular statement here, if you put this statement, this vote of the General Conference in full session next to the October reaffirmation statement, you put them side by side. The statement on the left is what we voted in full session. And according to our constitution, what is the highest authority in our church? Is it the ADCOM or is it the GC in a full session? Okay. So therefore, every decisions of the ADCOMs, which are a lower committee than the GC in full session, must be consistent with the GC votes in full session and cannot overturn or undermine the votes of the GC in full session. Does that make sense? Absolutely. So our GC vote in full session of February 1893 says, we are and of right ought to be free and independent of all connection, direction, dictation, interference, or control of the government of the United States in matters of religion or religious observances or religious institutions of any kind or degree. That would include offering your body as a living sacrifice for a holy God. That statement there overrides the October Reaffirmation Statement of 21, which says claims of religious liberty are not used appropriately in objecting to government mandates. That statement by our ADCOM goes directly against what our full session voted in 1893. Therefore, it's null and void, because the ADCOM cannot override the vote of the full church in full session. Now, you may say, well, that past time, that was 130 years apart. Yes, but we're still bound by principles established in the Garden of Eden 7,000 years ago. What is a mere 130 years? Truth is truth, no matter when it is spoken or where it was spoken. And so, just on this basis alone, the October 21 at Reaffirmation Statement is null and void and should never have been voted and has no standing because it cannot override the GC vote in full session of 1893. So these are various statements that we've made as a church in our past. And so I want to talk now about why the truth matters. And would you agree with me that truth matters?
Yes.
Gentlemen, if your wife says to you, does this dress make me look fat? That's where you have to decide whether the truth really does matter or not. That's an awkward question to answer. I have learnt with my wife, I have a lovely, gracious wife, when she says, did you like that meal? I said, I really liked it. I said, and I really appreciate what you made yesterday as well. And the subtle hint is, make what you made yesterday again, please. The point is that the truth matters. The truth matters. And it matters particularly in areas of medicine, because if I go to my doctor, and I trust my doctor, I have a really good doctor, and she's become kind of used to my quirks over the last 13 years, and we have a good relationship, and I trust my doctor, and I want to trust my doctor. My wife was raised in the Soviet Union, where doctors were used when people, where Christians were put in mental hospitals, they were injected with various drugs to make them go mad. Okay, this is what happened in the Soviet Union. And so people in the Soviet Union, doctors were agents of the state. And if the state wanted to kill you or the state wanted to make you go mad, then the doctor did what he or she was instructed. But here in America, we still have the idea that the doctor does what is right for the patient. And so I love my doctor. You know, she does a really good job for me. And I went to see my doctor. And if I go to the doctor and let's say I've got a problem with, you know, oh, I don't know, got a pain in my back. And she says, Mr. Vine, how are you doing this year? And I said, well, actually, you know, I've got a problem with my right knee. It hurts every time I bend it. My doctor is going to perform, you know, a physical examination, and she's probably going to be baffled at why my right knee is allegedly hurting. And the chances of me getting a correct diagnosis and the right treatment plan for the pain in my back are pretty much zero. Because there has to be truthfulness in the clinical relationship. If there is no truthfulness in the consulting room, whether it's with a psychologist dealing with depression or with an ENT surgeon dealing with a problem with your nasal passages or with your family physician, you have a problem with your back. If there is no truthfulness, then there can be no healing. So truth matters. The truth absolutely matters. We have tragic cases in our Western world. The thalidomide scandal, or in Pfizer in 2009 paid out $2.3 billion in damages for misbranding a drug called Bextra with the intent to defraud or mislead. And that's what was found in the courts. So the truth matters. As Adventists, we want to proclaim eternal truth. So we have responsibilities to seek truth and speak the truth. Because when we speak the truth, that is the starting point for healing when there's been difficulty in a relationship. Are we with me on this? All right. So I want to talk now just for a few minutes about the truth. And on the left, you have the official narrative, and on the right, you've got the counter-narrative. And the official narrative was the CDC, NIH, Fauci, Mainstream Media, General Conference. And on the right, you've got the counter-narrative, which was the Great Barrington Declaration, scientists, physicians, and truth seekers worldwide. So the official narrative was the virus did not come from the Wuhan Institute of Virology. The counter-narrative says it probably did come from the Wuhan Institute of Virology. The official narrative says, as per Fauci in Congress repeatedly, there's no federally funded gain-of-function research at Wuhan. We now know that there was federal funding for illegal gain-of-function research on bat coronaviruses at Wuhan. The official narrative was the virus had a random zoological origin at a wet market in Wuhan. That's known as the theory of proximal origins, which was drummed up almost overnight to divert attention from Wuhan. And the counter narrative is that the virus did not originate in a wet market in Wuhan. Now, we know that's almost certainly to be true, because every virus has a reservoir, an animal reservoir where it resides. And the Chinese government has been looking for the animal reservoir for this virus, and 3 years later, they still cannot find it, which tells you if there was no animal reservoir, it did not come from the animal kingdom. The official narrative was that there was no effective therapeutic options for the treatment of COVID other than the vaccines. The counter-narrative said that there were highly effective outpatient treatment protocols for COVID-19. The official narrative said those who took the vaccines would neither get COVID nor transmit the virus to another person. The counter-narrative was the vaccines, they may alleviate the symptoms. In that case, they may save lives in that sense, but they do not prevent someone contracting COVID, nor do they prevent transmission to another person. That was actually known from the very first emergency use authorization given for the Pfizer shots, because they actually said in the public, the PA release from the NIH and the CDC, that there is no evidence that these vaccines prevent transmission. So this was known from day one. The official narrative was the vaccines were safe and effective. The counter narrative is that one by one, the vaccines have been banned all around the world because of catastrophic side effects. That's the reality. The official narrative was that the vaccines provided full immunity from COVID-19, and if you take the shot, you won't get it. But the counter-narrative was every time a patient was vaccinated, only the manufacturer, the medical personnel involved, the hospital system, and the employer who mandated the shots, only they acquired full immunity, and that was legal, not medical. The official narrative was if you take the shot, you won't get COVID-19. That's what President Biden said on CNN. The counter-narrative is that the more boosters you get, the more likely you are today to get COVID-19. The official narrative was that social distancing and mask wearing were based on science. We now know, as per Fauci, that social distancing and mask wearing rules were simply made up on the spot without any underlying scientific basis. The official narrative was that any person deviating from the official narrative was spreading misinformation and their career was to be destroyed through professional, social, and financial cancel culture. The counter-narrative was that the reality was that truth speakers and the unvaccinated were demonized, including in our church. The counter-narrative is that absolute truth still matters in a postmodern era of moral relativism and personal subjectivity. And the counter-narrative asserts that truth has profound personal and social consequences if it is rejected by society. Now, this is with the benefit of hindsight. And some of you may dispute some of the things I've said here tonight, but I would, based on all I have seen and read, almost everything in the official narrative was false, and it was known to be false at the time by those pushing it. Almost everything in the counter narrative was true, and those who are now vindicated as the official narrative has fully collapsed around us under the weight of its own falsehoods, they were demonized by the mainstream media and by the General Conference through 2020 through 2022. My wife grew up in the Soviet Union, and the Soviet Union had very famous dissidents. You had Alexander Solzhenitsyn in the 60s and 70s. In the 1980s, you had famous dissidents like Andrei Sakharov. Maybe some of you remember that name. He was the nuclear physicist who disagreed with the path the Soviet Union was going on. And in the Adventist church in the Soviet Union, there was the official church, and they sent their kids to school on the Sabbath. And there was the unofficial Adventists, known as the true and free Adventists. And they were kind of basically demonized by the official Adventists, and they did not send their children to school on the Sabbath. And my wife, when she became an Adventist in 94, 95, when the Soviet Union had collapsed and lay evangelists spread from America all across the former Soviet Union, she remarked to me, she said that these people who were demonized, some of these in the church and society, there were many people who were demonized by society, by the Soviet Union, and by the church for being underground Adventists. They were demonized before 1990, but they were celebrated as heroes from 1991 onwards. And she says to me that the individuals did not change, society changed around them. And one minute you are demonized by society, and the next minute you are celebrated by society. One minute you're put in labor camps and left to rot and die, and the leader of the Free Adventists was actually sentenced in 1978, I think. And he was sentenced, he was about 75 years old, and he was sentenced to a hard labor camp in Siberia. The United Nations protested to the Soviet Union for his release. Solzhenitsyn protested for his release. Many international figures who were not Adventists wrote to the Soviet Politburo begging for the release of the underground church leader of the Adventist Church. And the Soviet Politburo ignored all their requests. And that old man was sent off to a hard labor camp in Siberia, where he died within 3 months of the conditions that he was forced to endure. But as my wife says, truth stands the test of time. And if today you are demonized by society, do not give up hope, because society may change tomorrow. The crowds are fickle. The crowds, most of the crowd, will follow the herd because few people want to stand out from the herd. What matters is the truth. And knowing the truth, and as Adventists, the ultimate truth is Jesus Christ himself for ourselves. Because when we listen to his voice through the word of God and through the conscience, therefore we are best placed to withstand the final deceptions that are coming upon this world from Satan. So knowing the truth, knowing Jesus Christ, is becoming ever more important in a world of profound falsehood and lies. The truth does matter. You might say that in the pandemic, this passage from Isaiah 28, verses 14 through 15, summarizes what happened to our church. Isaiah is speaking to the church leaders in Jerusalem. He says, therefore, hear the word of the Lord, you scornful men who rule this people who are in Jerusalem, because you have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell we are at agreement. When the overwhelming scourge shall pass through, it shall not come unto us. Why? For we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves. It is a truth that the GC did not follow the science, they followed the lies. They did not seek the truth, they sought massive federal pandemic funding. They did not bow before the convictions of the Holy Spirit upon the members' consciences, they bowed before the bullies of the mainstream media. They did not stand up for the convictions of our members, but they demonized members by their official media online and in print. The net result of this is there has been a catastrophic collapse of confidence in the public health community in general, in particular, and with some medical practitioners. And we have to rebuild that trust now, because I want to trust my doctor. And number two, there's a profound sense of betrayal, of anger, of alienation, of distrust, and disillusionment among Adventists worldwide with our church leaders, and to a lesser extent with the entire Adventist hierarchy, because during the pandemic, while people may whisper their support in private, in public, nobody in the hierarchy spoke up publicly for liberty of conscience of their members. Nobody. It was a systemic failure of leadership. Loss or fear of job loss, fear of losing their career in the church hierarchy, I think kept many of our church leaders quiet. This is the simple truth. I don't say this in anger. Please don't hear anger in my voice. I love many of these church leaders. They're my brothers and sisters in Christ. But the fact of the matter is, this is not a good sign for the final crisis. When people are bought and they have those careers and they have those positions, oftentimes they're bought and sold to that career, and they may agree in private with you, but in public they will never stand up for you. One person said to me, Conrad, I agree with what you preach. When the Holy Spirit convicts me to say the same things, I will speak up alongside you. I said, well, now would be nice. But that never happened. So what was the impact of this statement? Because the truth matters. The truth matters. Adventists worldwide saw our church leaders presume the right to override the convictions of the Holy Spirit and the consciences of individual members. This is a papal-like authority entirely foreign to the Word of God. Because of the hugely detrimental impact of that statement from 21, multitudes of members have lost any basic trust in the General Conference and have a legitimate sense of betrayal and abandonment. It appears to many members today that our hierarchy exists primarily for the financial benefit of the hierarchy and its functionaries, through the preservation of federal income streams to our U.S. institutions, and the concerns and consciences of members are no longer of concern to our senior administrators. Let me give you a simple case study that illustrates how this played out in practice. This is a true story. I've seen the paperwork. I've been following this story for 3 years. Many people have written to me with their stories, but this one really stands out. And I have permission from the young man and his mother to tell this story tonight. There is a young man in Australia today He was a 27-year-old teacher employed by a local conference in the Australian Union as a high school teacher. He graduated from college with an elementary education degree. He graduated with some debts, but by God's grace, he found a job as a high school teacher in an Adventist school. He purchased a home before the pandemic arrived, and he had a mortgage to pay. He was a healthy young man, taking much regular exercise. He lived the Adventist health message. He was a healthy young man. Then the pandemic came along, and his employer, the local Adventist conference, required him to take the shots. He was strongly opposed to this on grounds of liberty of conscience and on medical grounds. He had a history of problems with vaccinations. His physician submitted a bona fide medical exemption request, but that was denied by the educational administrator's self-appointed task force. After all avenues for receiving his waiver had been exhausted, and believing he had no choice or he'd lose his career and be unable to pay his mortgage and go homeless, this young man succumbed to the pressure and received the AstraZeneca vaccine. Shortly thereafter, he had a massive stroke with an 18-millimeter blood clot to his brain. His neurologist and cardiologist declared it to be idiopathic, which means arising spontaneously or from an unscure, unknown cause, as he was a physically fit and able and active young man who adhered to the Adventist health message and lifestyle. Almost 2 years later, he remains at home, partially paralyzed, unable to engage in work. He has lost his income. He's lost his home. His mother has resigned her nursing job to look after him 24/7 because he now needs nursing care around the clock. The Australian Union and his local conference have turned their backs on him and his repeated requests for assistance. I've read the paperwork. I won't show it here. But essentially, they've said, we fulfilled our legal responsibilities. You're on your own. Although they did say to him that if he recovers from the impact of this stroke, of which the cause they do not know what the cause of that stroke is, they'll be happy to reemploy him as a teacher. That's good and comforting news for him. Well, remember, he took the AstraZeneca vaccine. In 22, the AstraZeneca vaccine had already been banned in many countries around the world because it causes brain bleeds. In spring of 23, much to this young man's chagrin, the Australian government banned the AstraZeneca shots nationwide because they were determined to be linked with brain bleeds and strokes, as this man had experienced. And finally, in May 2024, AstraZeneca withdrew their vaccines worldwide after admitting in a UK court the relationship between with brain bleeds and strokes. That which was safe and effective, officially, that which was mandated by our church administrators, with calamitous effect, was then banned overnight by the Australian government precisely because it was not safe and effective. So far, the conference and the Australian Union have denied any and all responsibility for their part in this mess. The structure sails on, leaving broken bodies, destroyed lives, and betrayed trust in its wake. And nobody seems to care. But this is wrong. This is profoundly wrong. This is a human case study of what happens when church administrators overstep their boundaries and deny members the ability to follow the dictates on the conscience of the Holy Spirit. And the church, the hierarchy just moves, sails on as if nothing has happened, leaving broken bodies and destroyed lives in its wake. This is what happens when our GC administrators make illegitimate decisions, overstep their defined boundaries of delegated authority, and assume the right to trample on liberty of conscience. Had that man's request for a religious exemption been honored, he would still be working today. But his life has been destroyed by the actions of those administrators. Personally, this statement will get me into trouble. I believe that every General Conference administrator who was party to that reaffirmation statement should resign immediately because they overstepped their authority with catastrophic impact on the lives of innocent Adventists worldwide. I think they should resign. They no longer have our confidence. So what are the implications? Well, it's difficult to talk about this because had the General Conference said, with hindsight, we recognize we've made a mistake, and therefore we want to recognize we made a mistake, want to apologize, how can we make this better, and let's make sure we don't make these kind of mistakes again. What has actually happened is the General Conference issued a statement defending their right to make such statements. We discussed that last night. And they have basically cancelled any and all possibility of any discussion about their authority to make that statement. After my appeal to Adventist Nobility sermon in January 2022, the GC issued a global condemnation on Adventist News Network of any who would question their authority. To prevent any discussion at the 2022 GC session, the GC ADCOM stripped me of my delegate status because they didn't want me to speak up and raise this question from the floor. When Attorney Zirkle from California, from Loma Linda, made a motion to add the vaccine statement to the GC agenda in 22, Elder Wilson squashed that motion from the front, and we saw that last night. The Liberty and Health Alliance put together a petition to the General Conference administrators. Almost 25,000 Adventist pastors, doctors, nurses, members worldwide signed that petition, and no response was ever given to that petition. When Pastor Wilson did a question and answer with members at the Granite Bay Church in February 23, over 1,100 members were present. And they were encouraged to type on their cell phones and type in a question, and Elder Wilson sat on the panel with a couple of other pastors, like Pastor James Rafferty from 3ABN and so forth. And the number one question, because people could vote for it, the number one question that was up on the screen the whole afternoon was, why did the GC issue the reaffirmation statement that hurt so many Adventists? And for the entire afternoon, the panel refused to take that question, even though it had about 1,150 votes out of the people present. Essentially, our leaders are now hiding behind their lawyers. No discussion is possible, but we need a process of forgiveness, of reconciliation, and healing to begin, and that requires courage on the part of all parties. Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." And it is incumbent, I believe, upon our GC leadership to recognize their role in what has happened and to make the first step to reconciliation with the members who've been hurt by their illegitimate actions. So, over the years, I believe we have morphed. We began in the 1860s identifying as God's end-time remnant movement in prophecy, as the remnant movement of prophecy, those who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. As the end-time remnant people of God, we were fundamentally at odds with our wider environment. The USA was the second beast of Revelation 13, one of the end-time foes of God's people. But over the years, we have morphed. Lest we talk about remnant church, we become a respectable church. We crave and receive tax-exempt status, federal contracts for our colleges and our hospitals, subsidies and scholarships for our students. No longer are we fundamentally at odds with our wider environment. We've become fundamentally at ease with our wider environment. During the pandemic, when faced by huge social, economic, political, and media pressure, we morphed again. We didn't go back to becoming a remnant church. We ceased to be a respectable church. We became a regime church. We propagated the official lies. We canceled the truth speakers in our midst. We demonized our members who would not bow to the lies. And we chased federal funding for our institutions. It's not easy to talk like this, but this is the truth. And for us to have healing in our church, we have to speak the truth. In love, but we have to speak the truth. We became a regime church, implementing the dictates of a godless government that has no place for God in its deliberations, and we acted against our own members to preserve our revenue streams and our institutions. This is nothing new. In World War I, the Adventist Church in Germany supported the Kaiser Wilhelm regime over biblical truth and the concerns of the members. We encouraged our young people to sign up to fight for the Kaiser, and we encouraged our members to work in the munition factories, including on the Sabbath. As a result of this, the SDA reform movement was born. In the USSR, the SDA Church supported the communist demand for young Adventists to enter the Red Army in 1928. We changed in 1920. We said that Adventists are conscientious objectors to military service. And in 1924, under pressure from Joseph Stalin's regime, the All-Soviet SDA Congress, we changed our position slightly. So we said, now it's up to the individual conscience of our young men, whether they serve in the Red Army or not. And in 1928, the position changed again after further pressure from the Soviets, and the All-Soviet Adventist Congress voted to support and recommend our young men serving in the Red Army, as a result of which the underground SDA church began, and they were called the True and Free SDA Movement. And they lasted almost 70 years as an underground Adventist movement, faithful to the Lord until the Soviet Union collapsed. In Vietnam, to this day, 2024, the communist government expects school children to attend school on Sabbath mornings. And there is in Vietnam today an official Adventist church who send their children to school on Sabbath morning. And there is an underground Adventist church, many times larger than the official church. And they refuse to send their children to school on the Sabbath mornings. Historically, when Adventism faces totalitarian demands, we have split. We have retained an official Adventist church that has survived the regime. We thank the Lord for that. But they have always yielded to the regime's unscriptural rules, and they've sacrificed our members and beliefs in order to save our institutions. We have also had a split where an underground Adventist church comes into being in the same country, and that underground church is true to Scripture. That's what has happened historically in Adventism. Now, time and again, when those regimes fall, there's a process of reconciliation that takes place. And in some parts of the world, that reconciliation is more advanced than in other parts of the world. But some of these divisions between those who bow to the totalitarian demands and those who are faithful to Scripture and who are demonized by the official church, some of those divisions exist today around the world church. We may not be familiar with that too much in Maine, but as one who travels the world, I can tell you those divisions are still known by members who've gone through the trauma of a totalitarian regime. And I would say this at this moment here, don't think for a minute that you know which group you would be in when totalitarian demands come your way. Nobody really knows how they're going to respond to a matter of life and death. Nobody really knows how you would respond to the threat of a bullet from the KGB or the Gestapo. Nobody really knows. So as we look back on this history, rather than saying this group is bad or this group is wrong or this group is good, we say, thank you, Lord, that I was not forced to make that decision myself. And by the grace and so people post PTSD years and years after these events took place. But why am I talking about this again tonight? Because as I said last night, we are facing new totalitarian demands affecting all of humanity. The WHO is actively seeking via the international health regulations the authority to declare actual or potential pandemics, to issue mandates that override all civil and human rights, and to mandate vaccines globally. That's what they're openly and actively seeking for. And once they get it once, they'll never give up that authority. We're entering a techno-dictatorship, a dictatorship of technocrats. The climate change industry is also seeking climate change lockdowns to be held on Sundays to preserve our common planetary home. Disease X, Mpox, avian flu mandates and vaccines, these are all in our future. These are all being openly discussed by our political elites. And it won't be a surprise to you that the papacy actively supports the climate change lockdowns and the vaccination lockdowns. They support all of those lockdowns, not because they're particularly interested in your well-being, but because these initiatives cement a globalized technocratic dictatorship over all of humanity. They allow societies to accept the fact that you can override the convictions of the Holy Spirit on the consciences of individuals. Once we accept once, as in the last 4 years, that you can override your conscience, then it's easier for people to accept that in the next crisis. The papacy supports these initiatives because they help to usher in the final crisis of conscience and false worship that will precede the second coming. Now, when it comes to the climate change issue, the GC ADCOM did issue a statement in December 95 called the Dangers of Climate Change. It's an official statement. I wish they wouldn't issue these official statements because they don't age very well. And this is what they voted. It says the SDA Church officially requested all world governments to, quote, take steps necessary to avert the danger. Quote, by fulfilling the agreement reached in Rio de Janeiro, the 1992 Convention on Climate Change, to stabilize carbon dioxide emissions by the year 2000 at 1990 levels, and by establishing plans for further reductions in carbon dioxide emissions after the year 2000. That last sentence is an open check to the world governments to do what they want for climate change, as far as our church is concerned. We have already signed up to whatever climate change initiatives are going to come our way. Therefore, It is not surprising that if you just change the word vaccination for climate change, that statement could be issued in the future, which says the General Conference is convinced that not vaccination, but climate change programs that are being carried out are important for the safety and health of our members and larger community. Therefore, claims of religious liberty are not used appropriately in objecting to government mandates or employer programs designed to protect the health and safety of their communities. Once you've signed up an open-ended check to the world governments to implement whatever they want to do to restrict climate change, this is not a far, it's not beyond imagination, beyond reason to expect this kind of statement to be issued once again. And once again, our consciences to be trampled upon. So, as I look at, we look at the what has happened in the last 4 years, as I travel around the world, I see that we are facing a potential split along two lines in our church. It's come to the United Methodists, it's come to the Lutherans, it's come to the Presbyterians, it's come to the Episcopalians, and it's coming our way as well. On the one side, there will be Adventists who reject the GC ADCOM's assumed authority over their conscience, who hold true to scripture and our fundamental beliefs, and who reject the onrush of cultural Marxism and SDA institutions among our leaders, professors, and pastors, and it's more widespread than we like to admit. Then there'll be Adventists who accept the GC ADCOM's assumed authority over their individual conscience, neither afraid to contend for the faith passed on to us, as per Jude verse 3, or actually support the abandonment of scripture in favor of cultural Marxism. And you'll notice there's a remarkable correlation between those who uphold the mandates and attack others who don't take the shots, and those who support critical race theory, critical gender theory, LGBTQ normalization within our church, etc. There's a remarkable parallel between people who take one position and the other. So you might say, as I look at what's coming upon our church, that we're going to have to make a choice, each and every one of us. The church, when we talk about the church, we often mean the legal hierarchy, like the Northern New England Conference and the Atlantic Union, the North American Division, the General Conference. When we talk about the church as members, that's often what we mean. But the truth of the matter is, if the government of Maine were to cancel the registration, the legal registration of the Northern New England Conference, does that mean the Adventist Church would cease to exist in Maine? Yes or no? No, absolutely not. It means simply a functional unit that where we return our tithes and offerings to support pastors and educators, so forth, that no longer exists, but the body of Christ still exists. It simply becomes an underground church, which means it has no legal presence. So what I see happening as a result of the last 4 years and the onrush of cultural Marxism across our institutions is this, that we are going to have groups of faithful and convicted Adventists on the one side, and we're going to have institutional and cultural Adventists on the other side. Many of them are Adventists by convenience rather than by conviction. The Adventists on the left are independent of federal funding. The Adventists on the right, particularly our institutions, are completely dependent on federal funding for their institutions to remain alive. The Adventists on the left, the faithful and convicted Adventists, they uphold liberty of conscience. The cultural or institutional Adventists feel free to trample on liberty of conscience whenever financially or socially expedient. The Adventists on the left, the faithful and convicted Adventists, will one day establish, when the mark of the beast is imposed, an underground network of lay-led house churches. That's what we're going to be before Jesus comes again. The Adventists on the right, the institutional Adventists, will remain in a visible network of conference-affiliated churches and conference-owned buildings. The Adventists on the left, the faithful Adventists, will be able to preach and live the everlasting gospel and Bible truth freely because they have no fear of loss of having their church taken away from them by the conference or the government. The institutional Adventists, they increasingly self-censor the preaching of Bible truths if they happen to rebuke cultural Marxism. We see this in Canada today, where pastors are self-censoring in the area of human sexuality and marriage. Pastors dare not preach out biblical truth in Canada today, even many Adventist pastors, because if they do, the church will face a lot of hostile attacks from the Canadian federal government. So it seems to me that in Canada, we should already be going to an underground church in order to live and preach gospel truth freely and openly. On the left, we have faithful and convicted Adventists who reject the acceptance of LGBTQ ideology and the normalization of this lifestyle within our church, the reposturing that some conferences want. And on the right, we have institutional Adventists who are increasingly accepting LGBTQ ideology and the normalization of this lifestyle. You might say they're no longer Seventh-day Adventists, they are sodomite Adventists. On the left hand, you've got the faithful Adventists. They're focused on bringing the everlasting gospel to every nation, tribe, language, and people. On the right, we have our institutional Adventists who are focused on the preservation of our institutions, of our retirement funds, of the visible hierarchy and administrative incomes. On the left, the faithful Adventists, they seek the eternal spiritual benefit of individual members and non-members, no matter the cost. And on the right, the institutional Adventists, they seek the temporal, that is the earthly financial survival of our hierarchy and our institutions, no matter the cost. Now, you may say, Pastor Wine, that's a very harsh division. But this is what I'm seeing happening around us. It may not be popular to say this, but this is what is happening. And in every one of our institutions that are supposed to be bastions of the Adventist faith, increasingly they are battlegrounds of the Adventist faith, where those who are upholding biblical truth are fighting a losing rearguard action against the onslaught of cultural Marxism within our institutions. This is the reality, and this is affecting pastors and educators across particularly the North American division. So this is how I see this is where we may be going here in the North American division. Is very similar to the split that's taken place in the United Methodist Church, where you have the Bible Faithful Methodists have formed a new denomination, the Global Methodist Conference that is affiliated with the Southern Hemisphere Methodists, and the remains of the United Methodist Church in North America have now become essentially a woke ideological talking shop. And they'll probably go bankrupt in the next couple of years because their tithe base has collapsed. And so this is the pandemic merely revealed and exposed where each of our hearts are. They revealed whether we are willing to live according to our conscience and face loss because we believe in truth. And they revealed whether we are willing to accept the right to mandate on other people actions which go against their conscience or not. And I'm not pointing the finger at anybody here tonight, but I am asking each one of us today to take a look at yourself in the mirror tonight and ask where we were in the pandemic. Now, and given what we now know about the official narrative that it was almost all a pack of lies, and it was known to be a pack of lies by those propagating it, and maybe it's a call for humility on each of our parts, and a recognition that God help us next time this kind of nonsense comes around, and that we're in this together as brothers and sisters, and whatever the divisions and pains of the past have been, let us work together with our brothers and sisters and say, look, the pandemic is over. And I can forgive you if you, and please would you forgive me. And if I contributed to it, please forgive me, and vice versa, because we are stronger and we are more successful in mission when we are united together. And so we need to think of ways of how we come together and recognize the harms that were caused when people acted on the basis of falsehood against one another. The truth really does matter. So what do we do as Adventists? Well, this slide here is a slide that will probably get me into more trouble, but I put it up there. So the first thing is, what can we do as Bible faithful Adventists today? And the first thing I would say is, one option you have is do nothing. And recognize that the next time mandates come along, you're probably going to be thrown under the bus once again. And your livelihood, your career, your job, your mortgage, your home, your business, your marriage, your custody battles will all be sacrificed by our leaders to preserve their institutions, incomes, and status. That is not an option for any of us here tonight. The second option we have, and I would encourage you to do this, is to actively pray for our church leaders. Start praying for Elder Wilson. As I said last night and the night before, Elder Wilson is a champion for mission in our church. I believe his heart really is in the right place. But it's hard for one man to do something against the sheer inertia of all our divisions around the world. Pray for our world leaders that they will find the courage, no matter what the mainstream media may pressure them to do, to uphold liberty of conscience and to contend for the faith that has been passed on to us. You know, Jude is only one chapter in it. The third verse, Jude chapter 1, is only one chapter. Jude chapter 1, verse 3 says this: "Beloved, while eagerly preparing to write to you about the salvation we share, I find it necessary to write and appeal to you to contend for the faith that was once for all entrusted to the saints." So we are to contend for the faith. If we do not contend for the faith will be overwhelmed by falsehoods. And so particularly when it comes to our church leaders, When we elect church leaders and they work in conferences and unions and divisions, we do not pay them to go and do their job and go to their desk, write a few emails, sit in a few meetings, watch the trends that are happening and feel bad about what is happening, but say nothing in the committees, then go home and grumble to their spouse about what is happening. We don't pay our leaders to do that. We pay our leaders, as far as I'm concerned, with the tithes that we return, and I'm thankful we have leaders who do this. We return our tithes so that our leaders, in their sphere of influence, on the committees where they sit, when appointment decisions are being made, when budgets are being allocated, when ethical and philosophical decisions are being made in the conference, I'm hoping and praying that our leaders will contend for the faith that has been passed on to them as well. That they will fight and defend the faith that we have, not just that we have as members, but our leaders will fight for and contend for the faith in their sphere of influence. It is not enough just to go to your office and come home after 40 hours and grumble to your spouse. You're in that office for a reason. Who knows but you've come to the kingdom for such a time as this. And I thank the Lord for every leader who does stand up for what is right and true and proper. I would encourage you to pray for our leaders, pray for your conference president here, pray for your union president, that they will have the courage when those hidden moments, when decisions are being made that nobody sees, and there's a lot on the line, that they will have the courage to do the right thing. Pray for your leaders, because they have impossible tasks. And when they know that people are praying for them, it gives them courage and it puts wind in the sails of that ship of state, so the ship is going in the right direction. So pray for your church leaders. The third point there is more contentious. I put there, if the GC supports future mandates over the consciences of members, that's an important caveat. If the GC in the future supports future mandates over the consciences of mandates, I think we are well within our rights to establish a parachurch movement within the Adventist Church. And what is that? A parachurch movement would be a gathering, a lay conference of laity. They gather, they maybe incorporate, they return their tithes to that new lay entity that covers the whole of North American division, and then the committee allocates that tithe to conferences who are faithful to Scripture. And that way, the conferences that go woke will go broke. Very simple. And the members will determine where that tithe goes based on fidelity to Scripture and whether they are willing to contend for the faith that has been passed on to us. Now, I recognize this is when you touch the question of tithe, this is the sacred nerve in the Adventist Church. But Elder Wilson did say in his first sermon, hold your leaders to account. So we're going to hold our leaders to account. And if more mandates are imposed that override your conscience and the church throws us under the bus once again, I believe that someone somewhere will take the first steps to establish a parachurch movement. And we'll say, with modern banking and modern legal systems, we don't need the conference, union, division, GC hierarchy. We can collect the tithes ourselves and allocate them to the conferences that are faithful to Scripture. It's a revolutionary idea. It's kind of crossing the Rubicon from many administrators' perspective. But it's what we can do as members, because we were encouraged to hold our leaders to account by our current GC president when he was elected. And this is about the only way we can do it. So this may well happen if the GC supports future mandates over the consciences of members. And the fourth thing, we're not there yet, is migrate to an underground house church movement led by bivocational elders and pastors. That's where we're going to be when the mark of the beast is imposed. When the mark of the beast is imposed, the conferences cannot bank because they won't receive the mark of the beast. If they're faithful to Scripture, that means the conferences cannot employ pastors, they cannot employ teachers, they cannot receive tithes and offerings. Therefore, the conferences, when the mark of the beast is imposed, are basically history. So when the mark of the beast is imposed, we will be in underground house church movements led by bivocational elders who are elders and pastors of the same things in the New Testament. But we're not there yet in time. The mark of the beast is not here yet. We are stronger as a movement and more effective in reaching unreached when we work together. So therefore, I would appeal tonight, as I've appealed before to the church leaders, to that this annual council, this October, I know many of the church leaders will see this sermon. Many of you know that what happened was a profound mistake. So may the Holy Spirit give you the courage to rescind and apologize for the 2021 reaffirmation statement. It has been exposed to be a pack of lies. You took shelter in lies. Now you can stand for the truth. I want to appeal to our GC leaders to establish a fund to compensate Adventists who lost their livelihoods like that young man in Australia who suffered catastrophic physical damage from the vaccines they were forced to take because of the reaffirmation statement. It just adds insult to injury that that which was mandated in 22 was banned by the Australian government because of those problems. It's ridiculous. It's truly ridiculous. So I'd like to appeal to the GC to publicly affirm that in the future, they will defend the good conscience decisions of all Adventists vis-a-vis any and all future vaccination mandates. If we do that, the whole world will hear about the Adventist Church, because we'll be the only Protestant denomination that stands for liberty of conscience when the next set of mandates come out. And the book of Revelation and the three angels' messages, fear God and give glory to him, those messages are given in the context of the mandates of the mark of the beast, because the third angel's messages do not receive the mark of the beast. So the three angels' messages presuppose that you and I and planet Earth, everybody still has in that final crisis at least some liberty of conscience to respond in faith to God, no matter what the beasts of this world might do to them. So therefore, if we want to be known as the church, the movement that champions liberty of conscience, we can start today by affirming that we will uphold the conscience of our members vis-a-vis any future vaccination mandates. And finally, to rehire any Adventists who are fired by the denomination for living in accordance with the convictions of the Holy Spirit. As I was thinking about this, I added another appeal. And this is, there's a lot of text on the screen there, but let me just share what I'm saying. The US federal government is turning its back on God. As you turn away from God, you turn to Satan and his control. So the US federal government is turning now to its end time role as a war-making, persecuting, conscience-denying second beast of Revelation 13. We can see the second beast coming into effect before our very eyes. Even as we speak this year, 2024, satanic policies are being imposed by the federal government. As example, the new Title IX rules on gender identity are affecting all the colleges in America. Now, the Adventist Church cannot be a prophetic voice that God has raised her to be while she is financially dependent on the second beast of Revelation 13. Therefore, if we are to be the prophetic voice at the end of time, I would appeal to the Wilson administration to add to the agenda of the 25th session the question of divesting all institutions that receive federal funding from the SDA Church. Sooner or later, as we heard in our Q&A today, sooner or later we have to get off that federal train. Sooner or later. If we don't get off that federal train, then the financial ties of that federal train will mean that our institutions will persecute our members when the mark of the beast is imposed. So we have been blessed over the years by our partnership with Medicaid, Medicare, and all the rest of it. But that was when we had more of an ideologically benign government. We no longer have ideologically benign governments. We have ideologically driven federal governments. And sooner or later, this question has to come to the fore. The pandemic is a great catalyst for raising this question. Sooner or later, we have to get off that federal train, or we're going to implement federal mandates all the way through to the mark of the beast. So I've spoken a lot about other people here. This is my favorite quote from the Spirit of Prophecy. I have it printed out in the front of my Bible here. Many of you are very familiar with it. The greatest want of the world is the want of men. Men who will not be bought or sold. Men who in their innermost souls are true and honest. Men who do not fear to call sin by its right name. Men whose conscience is as true to duty as the needle to the pole. Men who will stand for the right so the heavens fall. The quote goes on. But such a character is not the result of accident. It is not due to special favors or endowments of providence. A noble character is the result of self-discipline, of the subjection of the lower to the higher nature, the surrender of self for the service of love to God and man. But the quote goes on. This quote is from the book Education. It is given under the prophetic inspiration for young people, not just old preachers like me. The greatest want of the world is the want of certain kinds of men and women who will not be bought or sold. This is a message for teenagers today, for young people. It's in the book Education. It's not in the book Counsels to Ministers. It's in the book Education. So Sister White goes on to say, the youth need to be impressed with the truth that their endowments are not their own. Strength, time, intellect are but lent treasures. They belong to God, and it should be the resolve of every youth to put them to the highest use. He is a branch from which God expects fruit, a steward whose capital must yield increase, a light to illuminate the world's darkness. Every youth, every child, has a work to do for the honor of God and the uplifting of humanity. So this is the counsel we've been given. And if you're a young person sitting here tonight, don't think that people such as Abraham Lincoln or Martin Luther King, they didn't appear overnight. Elijah and Moses did not appear overnight. God shapes and fashions you in your younger years because he knows the moment when you are coming into the kingdom for such a time as this. He knows the moment when you are going to be the tip of the spear for the kingdom of God. He knows the moment when you're going to be called to answer for the faith that you have within your heart and your mind. And he knows when you're going to have to contend for the faith despite the opposition of all around you. And so I'd encourage you as young people, and those young people watching online, the character that we read about here, the greatest one to the world is the want of men and women, will not be bought or sold, etc., who will stand for the right that the heavens fall. You can have that character by the grace of God as well. It is not the result of accident. It comes through self-discipline, or the subjection of the lower to the higher nature, the subjection of our physical desires and our fallen desires and our carnal nature for the overriding rule of reason and conscience in our lives, the surrender of self for the service of love to God and to man. It's my prayer that each one of us we'll cooperate with the Holy Spirit from this day forward. We'll cooperate with the Holy Spirit, and he will bring to completion the good work that he's begun in each one of us. So when that final crisis comes, you and I will be found in this group here. Men and women who will stand for the right, though the heavens fall. Men and women whose conscience is as true to duty as the needle is to the pole. Men and women who do not fear to call sin by its right name, who in their innermost souls are true and honest. Cooperate with God. Be sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit. Be obedient to the promptings of the Spirit in his word and in his upon your conscience. And God will develop a character in you that is fit for eternity. Let's bow our heads and close with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you allow us to go through these troubles. I thank you, Lord, that no trouble has come upon us, but you give us the grace to get through it. I thank you, Lord, that when you allow troubles to come our way, it's a vote of confidence like you've got this. And Lord, we've all got war stories, what's happened in our past. But Father, I pray that in these days of camp meeting, in the coming weeks and months, that you will so refine and shape our characters, that we will be heroes of faith in earth's final hours. Father, I pray that we will put away the gods of this world. I pray that we will wash our minds every morning through the water of the Word of God. I pray that we will receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We will ask for it and receive it each and every morning. I pray, Lord, that when that final crisis comes knocking on our doors, we will be ready for that moment, not because we are strong, but when Christ is in us, who can stand against us? So, Father, from this day forward, may there be less of us and more of Christ. Refine us, shape us, give us victory over the sins that beset us. May we run the race that is set before us. May we fight the good fight of faith. May we run the race that is before us, and may we keep the faith. And, Father, when you come on the clouds of glory with your Son, Jesus Christ, we humbly ask that you're coming looking for each one of us. Until that day, Father, may we be faithful, may we be strong, may we be loving witnesses for you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.